Council, let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council work session for this evening, Wednesday, April 17th, 2019. And tonight, on our Wednesday program, we get to start right away with our presentation, item A. This is Chris Collier is coming to the table, and he is doing his presentation for us, the Alliance with Housing Affordability, and Council President.
And I just wanted to note for the record before we started that Councilmember Cotton is not feeling well, so he will not be here this evening at all. He let us know shortly before the meeting that he wasn't going to be here, so just so anyone, if anyone is curious.
Yeah, thank you. Well, welcome, Chris. Nice to have you here. So I'll just let you take it away. You've got a slideshow, and we have the same thing on a handout here. Great.
I would like to introduce him.
Oh, thank you, Councilmember.
I am Elias on to this board, and we've been working with Chris for at least a couple of years now.
Two and a half years now.
And I just want to introduce you to this amazing personality and this hardworking man. He was born and raised in the Puget Sound region. He was awarded a master's in public administration in 2012 from the Evergreen State University while he simultaneously worked in Washington, D.C. for NASA's Office of Legislative and Intergovernmental Affairs, and then Human Spaceflight and Operations. Spaceflight, that sounds really lofty. Designed to return to the better Washington, he found work with Governor Inslee's office in constituent services, where he gained a deep appreciation for the multitude of challenges facing Washington residents, chief among them housing stability. Seeking to continue service to the people of Washington State and address the challenges they face more directly, he jumped on the opportunity to move to Snohomish County and work as AHA program manager in 2016, where he has worked since to advise AHA's mission and vision of no household being without a place to call home that doesn't break the bank. Chris is married with 1.5-year-old son and lives at the north end of Lynnwood in the urban growth area.
Just
welcome, Chris.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the introduction, for the invitation to be here to speak tonight. I'm just going to be giving you a brief overview of what the Alliance is doing for the city of Lynnwood and all the member jurisdictions. And I think my son might be here. There he is, right there in the back. So that's him, all 35 pounds of him. He's 1.5 and gigantic, bigger than the 4-year-old. So this is something that's my wife and my in-laws, mother-in-law and father-in-law. So
welcome.
So what I'll be covering today, as quick as I can, because I know we're all time limited, is an introduction to affordable housing, national, county, state trends, and local trends, and finally the Alliance's Housing Trust Fund. A brief background, the Alliance was formed in 2013 by a study done by Snohomish County Tomorrow that found there wasn't really a common forum to discuss issues of housing, which, when you think about it, really affect Lynnwood and all the neighboring jurisdictions in an equal fashion. And that's, there was no common forum for discussion. There needed to be one, so the Alliance was formed. It represents 12 cities, the town of Woodway, Snohomish County, and the Housing Authority of Snohomish County, making 15 board members in all. It's the shared forum for discussion, and 4 major work plan goals inform the work. That's technical expertise, data analytics, education and outreach, that's presentations like this one, and finally financial work. So the first 2 points, technical expertise and data analytics, you'll see in the first couple slides here through a variety of forms. And then outreach and education, like I said, is this, and financial work finally will be discussed in the Housing Trust Fund section at the end of my presentation. So getting right to it, what is affordable housing? What's subsidized housing? Affordable housing, really, I would encourage people to be literal. Affordable housing is a place that you can afford, and that means you spend less than 30% of your monthly take-home income to pay for. If it's an apartment, you spend less than 30% of your monthly take-home on rent. If it's a home, you spend less than 30% on your mortgage, insurance, utilities, property taxes, and so on. That's it. That's what we're talking about, is trying to get as many homes as we can below that 30% mark as we possibly can. There are a lot of reasons that homes cost more than 30% of your monthly take home, but really at the core of that issue is supply and demand. It's how many places we have for people to live and how many people are trying to live there. Subsidized housing is what you get when affordability gets tight. It's public dollars going to help people whose housing costs way exceed their income. And so it's to help them avoid making the choice between food and rent, or transportation and rent, healthcare, delaying healthcare, their healthcare so that they can keep a roof over their head. Subsidized housing is to help those people. That's helping seniors, it's helping veterans, youth, developmentally disabled, and your workforce. A growing portion of people that utilize subsidized housing are your workforce. They work full-time, they have good, decent jobs, but they still need subsidies. This is delivered through a variety of forms. The number of programs that I could mention are too many for here, but some of the high points are tax credits. That's low-income housing tax credits administered by the State Housing Finance Commission, supportive housing and housing choice vouchers through the housing authorities. There's a lot to say about each of those. I won't go into them in this presentation, but I can. All of these things, though, are more effective than the alternative: jail, hospital, and crisis treatment. I guarantee you, in every single program, they are much more. It is a ounce of prevention's worth a pound of cure. That's the deal with subsidized housing. And also, it's an investment in the future. It's helping break generational cycles of poverty and help people get ahead that traditionally wouldn't be able to if they don't have a place to call home. That's kind of where it starts. And the important thing to remember in all of these is that housing exists on a continuum. What affects the market affects affordable housing, the availability of naturally occurring affordable housing, and the need for subsidized housing, whose funding is not getting any greater. Think of it like a Newton's cradle. What affects one end will propagate down to the bottom end. And in the case of housing, it's as it goes to the end, it's some household falling into homelessness or unstable housing. So why are we where we are? This is a picture of a countywide map of the country. Sorry, I printed these out in grayscale. The blue counties, which includes all counties in Washington State, have a home-to-income ratio of 2-to-1. That means if your home cost $100,000, you made $50,000. This is in 1980. In 2017, the picture changes. All the counties in the Puget Sound region have a home sale price income ratio of 5-to-8. That means your home costs 5-to-8 times more than what you make per year. And you see that across the country, except in the Rust Belt. Why is that? This map on the left-hand side is net domestic migration. That means the orange states are states that people are leaving, and the blue states are where they're going. So the top three recipients of domestic migrants in 2012 to 2016 were Texas, Florida, and Washington State, in that order. Washington State received 53,000 new migrants from inside the United States, and a majority of those were below the age of 35. So people are coming from the Rust Belt, young people, by and large, and they're moving to the coasts. They're moving to Texas, Florida, California, not really, they're kind of leaving there because Florida's crazy expensive, or California is crazy expensive. So that's at the national, that's the national trend. Is the Rust Belt, really, people are just leaving because there's no jobs. Supply and demand in Snohomish County. Speaking of all those new households coming here, the line on the bottom, and I'm sorry for the contrast, the yellow line on the bottom is new households coming to Snohomish County. The dark line on top is new units built to house those new households. If you add up the gap, the difference between these two lines year over year, you get a surplus. 760 more units built than households came to occupy them in 2001, 548 in 2002, 756, and so on. You get up to a surplus of 3,661 more units created than households came to occupy in 2001 to 2004. 2014 happens, and look at how those lines diverge in contrast to the previous 18, or the previous 14, I'm sorry. We have way more households being established in Snohomish County than we are producing new units to house them. So this is the slide that I would point to. If you're looking for why is housing so expensive, this is it. In 2014, you see home prices take off, and they have not come back down because those two lines remain separated to such a degree, and the surplus is somehow impossibly negative. So that's the issue. This is countywide. What this looks like in the rental picture is these three solid lines, or four solid lines, are the inflation-adjusted, I want to stress that, adjusted for inflation, average rent for a three-bed, a two-bed, a one-bed, and a studio. A three-bedroom apartment, a two-bedroom apartment, one-bedroom, and a studio in the city of Lynnwood up until 2000 to 2017. If your income keeps up with this, sorry, I should back up and say this is, remember, this is 30%. You're trying to spend less than 30% of your income to afford these units. And so these dashed lines that I'm going to put up on the screen are 30% of each job's monthly take home. So this dashed line, which I was trying to make it contrast no matter what happened, but it didn't quite work. That dashed line, which you can see better on your paper, is 30% of the monthly take home of an elementary school teacher in Snohomish and King County. Next dashed line is a marriage and family therapist. You see that that dashed line actually goes down. Your marriage and family therapists have less money today than they did in 2000, if you adjust for inflation. That dashed line is a pharmacy technician. And I can send this to you electronically so it's a little easier to see. But pharmacy technicians I'd like to call out because they have gained spending power for housing purposes year over year from 2000 to present, and yet they can afford less than they could then. So even though you see your paycheck going up every year as a pharmacy tech, you can afford less. You're starting to stretch more. You can barely afford a studio in the city of Lynnwood today. The next line is dental assistants. They also have lost spending power year over year. Next is waiters and waitresses. And finally is childcare workers. A childcare worker has never been able to afford a studio in the city of Lynnwood for the last 17 years. And these are the people that we leave our kids with to go to work. So your childcare workers are doing one of two things, being very, very, very worried about their finances, or they're driving 1, 2, 3 hours each way to get to work. And then they take care of your kids, and then they drive home and do it again. So that's who we're talking about when we're talking about affordable housing, is the people that can't make rent and certainly can't make a home. They can't afford a home. So let's look more locally, yet more at Lynnwood, by the numbers. So in 2010, we had 3,500 people. In 2018, we've got 3,700 people, so the population's gone up by about 5%. You can't adjust that for inflation. The housing unit count has also gone up by about 5%, so that's pretty good. We're gaining about the same number of units as we're gaining people. The median income, if you adjust for inflation, this is between 2010 and 2017, the most current year we have data. If you adjust for inflation, that's gone up by 7%. So the median income in the city of Lynnwood's gone up 7%. That's pretty good. The problem arises when you have the average home sale price, if you adjust for inflation, is gone up by 56% in that same time frame. So in the last if you bought a house in 2010, it's worth 56% more today if you were to sell it. The price per square foot generally follows that. And rent, referring to the previous slide, has gone up by 40% across all the different unit types in the city of Lynnwood. So that's, income is going up, no question, but housing prices are going up a lot faster. And the disparity that you see between what you make and what it costs to live is really the problem that we're dealing with. And this affects all people. It doesn't affect people that are using, people that are having mental health challenges. It does affect them, disproportionately so, but it really affects everybody, including working professionals and people that are working way more than 40 hours a week. I didn't have time to put this in the slide presentation, but per the county assessor's office, the average home sale price in the city of Lynnwood was $533,000 in 2018. If you supply some fairly general loan terms, how much your debt-to-income ratio is, how much you put down on the house, how long the loan is, the interest rate, and so on, generally speaking, to buy that home in 2018, you had to make $136,000. That had to be your annual income. That's what the bank wants to see before they'll give you a loan to buy that house. You can play around with the loan numbers quite a lot, and I'd be more than happy to share all that with you. I bought a couple copies of this handout. It's a little wonky, but that's really what we're dealing with, is in almost every jurisdiction, if you have rational, not crazy loan terms, you're looking at 80,000 and north to buy a home. So more and more people that are working these jobs that I showed you are they're not able to save because they're paying a disproportionate amount of it to rent. So they can't put very much down, and so their loan terms are way outside what they can afford on their income. You better hope that you're a dual income household and that your spouse makes a lot more than you do, because that's a pretty steep ask for a lot of jobs in Snohomish County. So three ways to address this. I showed you the national picture. So at the national level, we can tell people to stop moving here. We could pass a law in Washington State that says if you're from the Midwest, you can't move here, which might not work. More seriously, you could encourage Congress to reinvest in the Rust Belt. You saw that people are leaving the Rust Belt, and a probable reason for that is that they're seeking job opportunities on the coasts. So encourage at the congressional, the national level, reinvest in the Midwest so that people stay there and seek economic opportunities there. State, at the state level, you can allow people to move further from where they work. If you've worked with realtors lately, there's the phrase, drive until you qualify. Drive 10 minutes further north or south of where you are, where you work, and the home price will go down by such and such percent. So drive further away means more congestion, or if you invest in mass transit, it's a little more feasible, light rail, bus rapid transit, and so on. So investing in mass transit at the state level could make a lot of sense, or could help alleviate the situation. At the local level, you can think about allowing denser and new types of housing units. And that's really what city councils and planning commissions have in front of them to address at the local level, is let's figure out new and better, new ways for people to live that match their lifestyle, their household type. One thing I forgot to include on this slide is also move the job centers. You may have heard of the Arlington-Marysville Industrial Center or complex that's just coming online or just getting through the process. Move the jobs outside of existing concentrated areas, so that people don't have to commute, and that it's feasible to live in Stanwood and work in Marysville, that there are more jobs up there, so they're not trying to get through the ever bottleneck. When people say, or when I say, let's build more housing, this is what people think of. This is a picture of downtown Hong Kong. They think, oh my God, you're going to bulldoze the Everett Bowl, or the Edmonds Bowl, and you're going to build 50-story skyscrapers. What people don't think of when I propose, let's build more places for people to live, is something like this. Like townhomes, or like this, which is cottage homes, which, being a Lynnwood resident driving around, I don't feel like this picture would be out of place in the city of Lynnwood. I feel like this would pretty much fit the look and character of the city, but has a lot more people living in it than single-family detached homes on 7,200, 8,200 square foot lots. So can all three of these things be accomplished? Absolutely. And should all these three things be accomplished? Yes. All three of these proposals at the federal, state, and local level need to be accomplished in concert to really, truly address this problem. That's really a heavy ask, but that's really, if I could wave a magic wand, it would be all of those things. So in the meantime, and this is moving into the third part, or the final part of my presentation, the Housing Trust Fund, in the meantime, we're looking at subsidized housing. That's a Band-Aid solution. It's one that isn't necessary if we have enough places for people to live in the right way for them. So we have public dollars going to help the people that are most in need, trying to get the biggest bang for that buck, through a countywide fund that all the Alliance members have the option to contributing to award just-in-time funds to projects at the tune of 5 to 15% of the total project budget. That is a small component of the funds, but has an outsized impact on those projects by being first-in money to show local support. I mentioned the Washington State Housing Finance Commission. On their scoring criteria, they require a certain dollar amount of local support, public dollars, that gets you a certain number of points for your application, and that can really set you above other projects. So it's first in money to get that local support, or it's last in money to make unexpected shortfall or fill unexpected shortfalls. Again, local dollars going to local projects, local or Snohomish County dollars going to Snohomish County people. It's a roundtable for stakeholder discussion. The Alliance doesn't control where the projects go. The Alliance just tries to bring interested parties together to make projects happen, and really to be that central forum for discussion to make more housing projects happen. The whole process is run, and compliance for affordability is monitored by the Alliance going forward. Funds are voluntary and flexible. Nothing is required, nothing is expected. This follows in the proud tradition of ARCH, a regional coalition for housing in East King County. They've assisted in the construction of over 300,000 units in the last 25 years, and that's really what the Alliance is trying to follow. So funds are voluntary and flexible year to year. Annually, the goal is to get to about $500,000. I made, including the city of Lynnwood, I'll get to that, for Ashley, go through almost 90 pages of paper filling out an application. So you need to actually have something meaningful to dangle in front of developers to make them want to go through that 90-page application process. This can be dollars. It can also be surplus land. The city of Snohomish often identifies 9 acres of county land that's sitting vacant on the outskirts of their city. That would be great for an affordable housing project, in part or in whole. In-kind donations, fee waivers, anything that we can figure out how to soften the financial impacts for developers so they can make a project that assists lower income people anything is valuable. The funds can be restricted in any way, shape, or form that the granting jurisdiction sees fit. That's, you know, the level and scope of oversight, authorization, reporting, how much, how often, where the funds have to be spent, the project they have to be spent on, population served, organization the funds go to, whatever else you can think of, that's all, that is all open for discussion. The 2018 funding round, putting the fun in funding because I'm a dad and I can't stay away from the bad jokes, we had $655,000 in funds to distribute, $650,000 of that came from Snohomish County, $5,000 came from the town of Woodway, which I like to call out because that's almost $5 per capita. If every jurisdiction in Snohomish County put towards housing to that tune, it would be about $2.5 million on an annual basis, which is, so that's a big deal. So I appreciate the town of Woodway for doing that. The notice of funding availability was advertised last August. Three applications were received. The projects had to, as you probably all know already, the projects had to assist the homeless, spend the funds before June 30th of this year, and go to capital funding. Three projects were received. The city of Lynnwood was one of them, and granted $100,000, which since the project has now gone by the wayside, has been split equally between the two remaining projects, Cocoon House, which you saw in the Everett Herald this morning, and Compass Housing Alliance in the city of Edmonds. But I intentionally left the city of Lynnwood's application here because I wanted to thank everyone on the council and everyone in the city for making that application, because that project was fantastic. I look forward to it happening in the future, whether at that site or somewhere else, because it was a very necessary project, and it's very commendable. So heartfelt thank you for that, and to Ashley for going through the application process that I put her through. 2019 and beyond, it's unlikely that the Alliance will have the funds to run a funding round in this year. Remember, $500,000 is what we're looking for. Right now, there's about $28,000 between the town of Woodway, city of Arlington, and city of Snohomish. So that doesn't quite add up to $500,000, but that will be rolled into hopefully something more substantial in 2020. In the meantime, we're going to be incorporating all the learning that we did in 2018's funding round. That was quite the educational process. It continues to this day, getting the money out the door to the other two projects. So incorporating all that into policies and procedures, and looking forward to 2020 and beyond. So that is my presentation. I've tried to keep it as quick as I could. If you have any questions, feel free.
Councilmember Frizzell.
Can you give us a little history of when AHA got started, why it got started, how it was founded, where it gets its funding, a little bit more about the organization?
Yep. Snohomish County Tomorrow is where this idea all came from. In 2008, Snohomish County Tomorrow studied the issue of housing affordability. In 2008, housing affordability was almost as bad as it is now, that issue, and so they put together a study of what should we do about this. The output of that study is all the cities should get together and work collaboratively, discreetly from Snohomish County Tomorrow. So from when that study was done in 2008, 2009, 2013 is when the Alliance was officially formed. In between was all the going back and forth with the lawyers and getting everyone on board and kind of hammering out what it would be. How it's paid for is every jurisdiction is invoiced member dues in April. It's calculated on a per capita basis based on the Office of Financial Management's population estimates for each city in that year. So if I recall correctly, the city of Lynnwood was below $10,000 for the year to support my salary and to basically keep the lights on for the Alliance. I'm the only staff person that works for the Alliance. Officially, from a legal perspective, I'm a housing authority employee. The housing authority was part of this discussion and said, we will provide the administrative overhead, the payroll, the health insurance, and all that stuff. Give them a desk, feed and water me occasionally. So I'm a housing authority employee with the sole purpose of doing whatever the Alliance Board tells me to do. So the Alliance was formed in 2013. The first program manager was Christina Gallant. She created the housing profiles for all the jurisdictions in 2014, 2015. Part of my work outside of the Housing Trust Fund has been to make those housing profiles again and make them better and faster. So that's one of the big outputs of the Alliance between 2013 and 2015 was those housing profiles in support of comp plan updates. Christina departed in early 2016. They found me in mid 2016, and I started and have been continuing her good work since. So, did that answer your question? Is that?
It did. I still have more questions.
Well, I'll stay here until you're done.
Well, I'll give other members an opportunity.
Well, you can also call or email me too, so I'm always happy with that. So.
Anyone else? Yeah, Councilmember Hurst.
Thanks for coming. As far as the funding, the 12 cities and the county, but it looks like really we're more dependent on the county's generosity with REIT funds than member cities contributing a lot of money.
For the trust fund.
Yeah.
Yes.
For the trust fund.
Yes. So the backstory on that is just briefly that is an aberration. It's a little unusual because a state law that passed in 2017 gave jurisdictions that collect REIT funds, which is the county and also the city of Lynnwood and everyone in which homes are sold, collects REIT funds. That's real estate excise tax funds on mm-hmm. the sale of real estate. Those funds are normally restricted for public works projects. This state law said between 2017 and June 30th of 2019, you can spend up to $1 million of those REIT funds on affordable housing projects that assist the homeless. So the county quite unexpectedly said, hey, that seems like fun. And we just talked to Chris, he just came bothering us. Let's give him, or the Alliance rather, $500,000. I learned about that on January 18th in 2018. And so all at once, the Housing Trust Fund came together. The town of Woodway kind of muscled that through their town council, but it happened very suddenly and very quickly. I don't anticipate that will be the landscape going forward. I don't think that a single funder for the Housing Trust Fund is really a healthy environment. It's certainly appreciated. You know, it's absolutely a wonderful thing. But I don't expect that to be the norm.
So what do you expect to be the future funding then?
My hope is kind of a piecemeal approach following an Archer's tradition where everyone, you know, I'm kind of making the rounds in 2019 talking about the learning process, the successes, and how this can work. And with the hope that it's kind of everyone puts in a little bit, what everyone can afford in a given year, with one jurisdiction, and this follows an Archer's tradition where one jurisdiction has a particular interest in seeing a project happen or just really wants something to happen for some reason. I mentioned the 9 acres of land in City of Snohomish where they might obtain that from the county or somehow that would be sent to the Alliance, like, here, use this. So everyone does a little bit and then kind of one big benefactor on a given year on a rotating, flexible, voluntary basis. That's the hope. It's up to individual councils to make that happen.
Yeah. Is there anything in the state legislature? Are they extending that REIT?
There is. I don't know if the bill has made it out of the legislature yet, but there is a proposal to extend that sunset and expand the scope to not just homeless housing, but also affordable housing. So they are trying. I'm not sure. I haven't checked on it recently. But
okay. All right.
But they're trying, yes.
Yep. Thank you.
Any other questions for Chris? Did you have more, Christine, then?
Sure.
Okay.
So is Woodway giving anything other than $5,000? Like, do they say, we've got a piece of land set aside and
Woodway,
invite a developer?
Woodway, no. But they did continue their contribution at $5,000 per year for the next, I believe, biennium. Just let me get that. For the next biennium. So,
okay, and I think my other questions about REIT were answered, so
okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, anything else? Yeah, Council President?
For the way that the trust fund is set up, is it also something where you could receive monies similar to a trust, like from an estate that someone's passed away, things like that, or are you looking just from jurisdictions?
That's an issue that kind of crossed our minds but didn't really get a definitive answer. I don't believe there would be any prohibition against that, but I don't have a final word on that. I would like for the answer to be, yes, that would be fantastic and perfect. I don't know for certain.
Okay.
I don't believe arches cross that bridge, so that would be kind of blazing new territory. So.
Okay.
Yeah, Councilmember Hurst?
That was something else. As part of your technical expertise or analytics, any study on rent control and how that all, that's starting to be the hot topic right now. Yeah.
I haven't studied rent control as the program manager. I know that it's a can of worms from my academic studies. I know that Oregon, in their last session, passed that statewide. But what I will say is that it's, I would prefer that rent control is not necessary. I understand that it can be a tool to address issues of housing affordability and access to housing without breaking the bank, but there is another way. So it's kind of a in case of emergency break glass option that comes with challenges and something of a Pandora's box. But so can it work? Yes, but it doesn't have to be used. So, but I can look into that more, certainly.
What's the other way?
Providing places for people to live. So keeping housing prices closer to people's incomes. You know, so you can either keep the housing price close to the income or keep the income close to the housing price. And right now, those two lines are diverging. And that's the issue that we're dealing with. And so addressing one of those two lines or both of them simultaneously, you know, there's a lot of ways to do that. But from my perspective, working in housing is, you know, looking at having enough places for people to live in a variety of forms, accessory dwelling units, townhomes, cottage housing. You know, not every recent college graduate couple needs three bedrooms and a front and backyard because they just got out of living in a shoebox called a dorm room, so they're pretty comfortable in something much smaller. So, you know, there are a lot of different housing options and configurations that we haven't really considered. Or not that we haven't considered, but that people often forget. It's called the missing middle. You'll hear that discussion or that term thrown around, and we really forget the missing middle. That's kind of what I was getting at with those two pictures of downtown Hong Kong and townhomes, is people often think you have single-family detached homes, you have 50-story high-rise condo buildings, and there's nothing in between. But there's an awful lot in between. There's an awful lot of different ways people can live quite happily that suit their household type and their living style that make them very happy. That we often don't consider. Yeah. Zone 4 build, you know, that's zoning, that's the market, that's developers, that's what they think about when they want to do a project. So it's a lot of people involved in that. But I think that would be my preferable, more organic, market-driven approach. So.
Okay. Good. Thanks.
So one thing, if I can jump in, to follow up on that, this work that I referenced about assessor home sale data, this is something that I will probably, if you have liked my presentation, invite me back in the future. That's really going to be the focus of what I talk about is, you know, what does it cost to buy a home that is more modest? What does it cost to buy a duplex or a triplex? And also, how many of them sold in Snohomish County in the city of Lynnwood? And really get at the point that we aren't building a lot of variety. We're building a lot of single-family homes with front and backyards, three bedrooms, 1,500 to 1,800 square feet, which is a lot more house than a lot of people want. Yes, ma'am.
So how do we entice builders to do that?
That is a question that I haven't been asked to study yet, but I need to. So that's something that I need to work on. That's the next step of kind of this technical and technical work is trying to figure out how to get there. I have good connections with the Master Builders Association, and you know that is a conversation for me to have with them to try and figure that out.
Because as I see it, as we look towards the missing middle, is smaller homes on smaller lots that build equity,
right,
that aren't rental units. And I'd be interested in hearing some possibilities there that satisfy the market, as well as the builders, and provide wages and the whole wraparound economics of it.
Right. That's something that I need to do and that I can also work with city staff on. I know I recently met with Todd Hall and a couple others in the planning department to, and that was not thrust of the conversation, but that kind of, that was a relevant question in that discussion. And that's something that I can work with them on, that everyone, you know, myself, them, can work on to try and find the answer for you. So,
thanks.
So if you tell them to work on that, they'll call me and then we'll all work on that. So.
Coincidentally, I met with a real estate investor and a developer today in my office. And they came with the topic of compliments and concerns about our building department. But in fact, they talked about this missing middle, and they are into building townhomes, which is one of the missing middles. And so the example they gave was the new big houses, I think in your area, that are across the street from the Fisher building. And they said, so here you have Fisher building, and then right across the street you have these enormous mansion houses going for what, $6-8 million, I don't know. And they said, that doesn't make sense in the zoning. So I have hooked them up with David and Todd, and I've asked, because Todd and Ashley are doing a white paper on housing right now. So they're studying this right now. So I asked the developers to go and inform them again on what they're thinking. So that conversation has started.
And that white paper
in the
is
city.
What they wanted to talk to me about. So,
yeah,
so I'll help them with
so
that.
So thank you very much. Councilmember Sessions?
Thank you. I know that in talking about this that we need all sorts of kind of housing, a variety of housing. And, you know, like the mayor said and others, bringing condominiums back and something that we can build equity would be so helpful. One reason, though, why these houses aren't obvious yeses to me, the cottage-style houses or these other cute little things that are really close together, is the concern of fire safety. And so it's not an obvious yes for me. I see this in the county, and it makes me nervous. And it makes my firefighter husband nervous. Mm-hmm. And I know that's kind of a concern of why not to do this in our city-like area. So mm-hmm. What do you want to say to that?
Or not?
Well, gosh. I think that is a valid concern. I think, you know, that's a discussion that I'm glad that you're having that thought process. I'm glad that you're thinking that, because that's what I want to hear, is that discussion of, well, why shouldn't we do this? Okay, let's see if we can address those issues. Let's see what we can do about that. Because I don't have a clear-cut answer for that question right now. That's something that I'd want to both go back and study on my own and pull in other experts, like your husband, on discussing how do we address that? How can we address those other issues? Traffic is one that people often bring up. Like, but if you build more houses, then there's going to be more traffic, and what do we do? Well, I don't have an answer for that, but experts on traffic can help us answer that. So there's a lot of other disciplines that are involved in answering that question about public safety, fire safety, traffic, utilities, and all the rest. I am convinced, however, that there are answers to those questions. You know, the city of New York, I don't want Lynnwood to be New York, but New York seems to have addressed that to some degree. And so there is learning, there is expertise that we can draw on out there to find answers to that across the country and throughout the world. So I'm not sure if that's a real satisfactory answer of punt, but I think that's something that we can address, but it is a valid concern, and I welcome that conversation.
Councilmember Hurst.
To the two council members, I was going to say Sutton. Sessions point, so I've sat in townhomes in Woodinville that are for sale, and they're all sprinkled. Mm-hmm. They also have firewalls in between, so there are ways to work through that.
I bought a townhome. It's the Manor Cottage is just off 164th, so I'm pretty comfortable living there. And it has a sprinkler system throughout and a variety of safety features. So that's my personal answer. Is, you know, there are county city codes that we can put in place to enhance safety.
All right. Thank you so very much.
You're very welcome.
Is your family still out there? They're not in here.
I'll go find them. Thank you so much. If you have further questions, please feel free to let me know. I am always available. So thank you very much. Have a great night.
Thank you, Chris.
Mayor?
Yes.
I might also, I also do want to quickly recognize in the audience, Mr. Ulrich, who is with us today.
He is a student at Portland State University, and he had has a project where he needed to attend a meeting talking about affordable housing, and it just so happens that tonight happened to be that night. So he's joining us and trying to participate and learn a little bit more. So,
terrific. Welcome. Welcome.
We have. My name is Uri Chassobeno. I'm from Cameroon, Africa, and I am a student at Portland State University. Actually, I have a course, a class this quarter on affordable housing, and the professor was, one of the assignments was to assist in one of the public meetings talking on of affordable housing. And she basically said, no matter what will be the theme or the subject there, just she wanted to prove that I have assisted on a public meeting, and it has been actually very interesting for me, and I've learned a lot. And I think I have also a question for Chris. So that's it, basically.
Well, welcome. Thank you.
Well, he's still standing out there. You can probably catch him.
Thank you.
All right, let's move on to B. We have a couple of liaison reports tonight. It looks like Councilmember Frizzell.
I just wanted to thank Executive Assistant Beth for making that connection when that email came in, and she just kind of wrapped herself around it and made it happen, and got them connected ahead of time as well. So nice. Thanks for going the extra mile.
Yeah, good. Okay, we're moving on now to B. Councilmember Ross.
Thank you. I handed out the copy of what I'm going to talk about tonight, and I have visual art aids here. So anyway, last night was the Arts Commission meeting, so it was a great timing to talk with them about what's happening and see some of the things that they're handing out, which, you know, iHeart Lynnwood is coming back. You can't have these yet because they haven't been released. That's for a different commission. And Explore is still going on. So everybody get out there and look. I saw one of the eggs last night. It's amazing. So don't miss that. Commission is extremely busy. They are extremely engaged. Right now, the 27 eggs are out in the community. They were responsible for getting the eggs to the artists and getting the eggs to the stores, and then they'll be getting the eggs back here to City Hall and setting up that display, and then they'll be also participating in the reception for and the auction for the eggs. And so it's a large endeavor. Last year, the commissioners themselves provided the food and the entertainment, and everybody had a really excellent time. It was a terrific event. Same with the Art of Wine in Lynnwood. It was a tremendous success. 303 people showed up, which, considering this was the first time we ever had one of these, was a pretty big deal. People loved it. I was there for a little while. It was really exciting to see people watching the artists do their work and getting wine and enjoying the food. Some of the things that commissioners are doing on their own, one of them is on the PFD task force, which we talked about the other day. He's an architect. Rainieri, one of our commissioners, just won the Everett Mayor's Arts Award for her work at the Children's Museum. And two of them, husband and wife on the commission, have a very successful art gallery in Seattle. And another commissioner teaches art at high school and does other things as well. He's taking a group of art students to New York this within a couple of days to visit every museum they have. I guess it's going to be an exhausting trip from what he was talking about. He was the person who did the designs for the little library. That was one of the prizes at the fair on 44th last year. And they did pick it up and they did build it. So that was pretty exciting. they also participate in a lot of things. They're going to be having a table at Shakespeare in the Park, and we're going to have other activities. The other activities will have participation from the Arts Commission. We did get a grant for art at one of Cedar Valley School art program. That Fred announced that last night. New signal box wrap, which is going to be big hair and blue eyeshadow, which is hysterical and I think a wonderful idea. They do still have the artist receptions at the convention center. That's at least twice a year. And the art installations here at City Hall. And they're always looking for ways to improve access to the arts in Lynnwood. So we're kind of tossed out the idea of expanding the 1% for arts, as well as having a revolving art fund that could be created from that 1%. Rather than putting the art on your building yourself, you could put money into a fund and pay for public art throughout the city. There was an issue that came up with the project on 36th, and they're going to actually do an official letter to the council. I really don't want to talk about it until we get that, but we need to honor our volunteers when they actually produce something, and that did not happen. So I will leave it at that and let them bring their own voices to you and talk about what happened. Just joined the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Commission and really have enjoyed interacting with that group. What an exciting bunch. They were here tonight practicing for their Step Up conference, which is going to happen next Friday. They're going to have a panel. They've been working on a video, and they're going to have presentations and introductions, and people are going to get to know about this commission. And they're very, very excited about participating in that. Several of them went to several different MLK events and talked about that. They did their annual report. And they picked the design for this wonderful decal, which is going to be showing up all around Lynnwood. You can't have it yet because they're going to do it officially. You see them. We have one on the door, and we have one on the exterior of the building. And it's an initiative to get businesses to display this so people will know that no matter who you are, you're welcome in Lynnwood. And they got our welcome in, I think I counted 11 languages on this decal, so that people will know that they are welcome to come to Lynnwood. Let's see. And there will be different ways that that's going to be incorporated. I talked about that the Step Up conference. And probably the single biggest issue that this commission has brought forward is they are just chomping at the bit to look at our policies and see what can be done to broaden the equity in the city. And they're very excited about the idea of being able to do that. So part of our charge is going to be giving them some policies to look at and make some recommendations. Next time I'm here, I'll do the Parks Board between the date that we were appointed and the snow, and then a quasi-judicial presentation that they had last month. I have not been able to attend, so I promise them I will talk about them way more next time. And as with all our boards and commissions, the volunteers are very hardworking and looking to provide insight and recommendations to the council and the administration, and are completely dedicated to their mission.
Thank you. Councilmember Sutton, looks like you've got, it's not listed here. C, presentation.
Thank you.
Your liaison work, boards and commissions.
Excuse me. I just want to also kind of clarify a little bit. Chris hit on it, but he didn't go into a lot of detail, and I just want to throw this out again. He has actually taken the lead on doing a housing data project. And that's what he was mentioning and talking about. And it's development of the computer program that combines housing and demographic data from multiple sources that can be updated as the data sources are updated. The program will allow for quick generation of city-specific housing programs, will allow and demographic data trend reports, and is currently being tested with a City of Edmonds housing profile report update in support of the city's strategic work. So we are, I think we're about 16 individuals that represents the various towns and cities in our county. And so there's always something that's flowing back and forth, and we basically kind of use each other as sounding boards when it comes to our work in our cities and our towns. So I just wanted it to, he talked about housing trust in a lot of detail, but one of the things I want to point out is that the former director, Paul Krauss and Chandra Emery, who was a senior planner, were originally part of that discussion when it comes to the housing trust fund. And they basically kind of motivated the rest of us towards the fact that we continue to look for funding and grants and so forth in order to make that realization happen. So just to clean up a little bit on the alliance. My other is Snohomish County tomorrow. And basically, this is a growth management advisory council. And we've got a real, under this particular act, cities are expected to make key decisions about growth, choices about where and how to accommodate new residents, how they can find jobs, businesses, be encouraged to locate in our area, and how to best provide public services. Almost every program we have or meeting we have, there is always someone there that is either talking about transportation, talking about the manufacturing industrial centers, talking about how do we get more jobs that have livable wage earnings. There's always someone that comes up again with a question, which of course kind of causes you to pause and say, oh, is that workable? I don't think we can do that. Maybe we can do that, you know. So that's what I like about this this interaction of Snohomish County tomorrow. Actually, George and I recently, and I think, if I remember correctly, Art, you were there too at the 2050 event. And this is a group of folks that represents the various areas in our county that are coming together now, and they're actually sharing a vision and talking about what services possibly will be needed by 2015. Talking about area growth, talking about where specific cities, what specific cities can do to fill in the gap that they're trying to make. So that's look for more information on that. We work with the not only the city county government, but also the tribes, Tulalip tribes, and they're part of this discussion about this whole picture of how the Snohomish County should look in not only 2015, but what it will be looking at between now and 2025. By 2025, it is expected for more than 200,000 people to be in our county. That's a lot of people. And we need a lot of homes, a lot of affordable homes. And I just really appreciate Chris again kind of emphasizing that. So that's Snohomish County tomorrow. Again, there is ongoing discussion, and there will be some other accomplishments that will be coming out of this group over the next 2 to 6 months. And my last liaison duty is with the Snohomish Health District Board. And of course, you know, without them, we wouldn't be a healthy county. We wouldn't be a healthy community because their emphasis is to maintain healthy citizens by enforcing the laws regarding health and sanitary measures for the protection of public health. They do a lot of education as well, going into schools, talking about the importance of health, importance of wellness, the importance of exercise. They not only do that, but they also do a lot of wonderful things in terms of just actually interacting with the various cities and making sure that their needs are being taken care of. As you know, we've had a measles outbreak. It's really, really serious now because it's not only just countywide, but it's also nationwide. And of course, the focus is on measles and the opioid addiction. Drug use. Several health board members, along with healthy staff, recently traveled to Olympia. I was one of four board members that went and accompanied the staff. We traveled to Olympia and participated in the National Public Health Week on March the 6th. We spoke and met with a lot of our legislators on public health funding and the need to increase the levels so the health district can do its job fully, because they're not fully funded as they were in the past. And then on April 6th, health districts had its annual health championship awards, and the health district celebrated its also 60th anniversary. I was honored to present awards to a few of the local Lynnwood honorees. They were Sue Walden, and I think we all know Sue and her husband Mark, who drew the emergency shelters during the winter months. She was presented with for being a maternal and child health wellness advocate. That's one side I never knew about her, but that was really fun. The other honoree was Maria Marano Bianco, who is a registered nurse with the Edmond School District, and she was honored for her work in school-based health services. And then there was a little deli. It's called Jackson Number 607 Deli. Even though it has a Lynnwood address, it's not in the city of Lynnwood, but it was honored for the best fast food establishment, which was kind of fun.
I'd love to go check that out.
Yeah, really. It's on 164th. It's not too far from that Walgreens, Walmart area, Starbucks area, et cetera.
Okay.
And of course, I also serve as the Program Public Health Policy Committee. I'm the chair of that. We continue to focus on keeping our public informed, and I think some of the concerns that we have now is that we're finding a number of students that are not vaccinated, and that raises a lot of our concerns because of the fact that, you know, disease can spread very rapidly. So we're now discussing how can we actually reach the parents, because the schools do not have the staff to call, to follow up, that type of thing. So that's going to take a lot of discussion before we come up with some really solid plans. And of course, funding is always an issue. Grants, we're trying to look for different grants so we can reinstate the services that we lost because of the recession. So that's pretty much what my area is doing. Thanks for listening.
Thank you. All right, do you need a break?
I think if there are any questions for either of the two liaisons that presented tonight, we could do that and then we'll move into a discussion. I don't think we need a break quite yet. Does anyone have any specific questions?
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. I didn't know what I didn't know. So thank you for the education.
Yeah, it's nice.
I'm curious for council members. Son, what was the reaction? Do you get a feeling that the legislature is going to do some better funding for health districts?
I believe there is some money that is coming down. I don't know if it's federal money or what it is, but there is going to be a pot that comes down to the governor's office, and the governor then will be the person, and along with input, will be the one that will distribute that money, because it has to be countywide distribution. So it's not as though that one agency is going to get $2 million or something. It will be divvied up.
Art has some information, it looks like.
No, I just want to, from the executive, say we appreciate these reports from the council liaisons. You know, the timing is perfect. We have next Monday, the 29th, an opportunity for the council, the chairs of the boards and commissions, and staff to all discuss, you know, the big issues facing the city in the next couple of years. Then we have the joint board and commission meeting that occurs in May. I don't know the date. In May, there'd be another opportunity to continue that conversation, because one of the things, you know, we're trying to do is increase the flow of communication between council, the executive, and the boards and commissions. So this is, really appreciate the council doing this.
And maybe Councilmember Sutton, the Sister City group is another place where you're representing council, and things are happening in that group, like the students are now leaving in September to go to Damyang out of Lynnwood High School. So they're out there fundraising, getting sponsorships from organizations and the like. I don't know how many, actually. Yeah. It's probably about equal to what they sent, which was 19. Yeah. So anyway, that's moving along. And then they're looking at expanding the association past Korea so that they'll start inviting other members. If you know their committee members who want to work on it's more of a generic sister city organization because it's been fully Korean to date. And I know Gino is looking to look at the next city that you might want. Yeah.
Did we join the international?
I believe so.
Sister City International?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
We did?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, gosh. That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Well, let's move on to item E then. This is your Youth Commission discussion, and I'm going to turn it over to Council President to lead.
Thank you very much. If you will recall, or as you will recall, in the recent past, just before the end of the year, we discussed a youth commission and kind of what we were looking for by way of council, and we appointed three people to serve on that commission, and they have met a few times. They met with some people in the school district. There's some information. I would first like to ask if either one of the members that are here would like to say anything about that, because I think information coming from you would not be as filtered as it would for me, because I'm not in the situation. So,
okay. Yeah, we did. Councilmember Ross and I, we did make it to Lynnwood High School and met with the Honor Society there during a break. Within the Honor Society, teacher, or the, I guess she, what is she, yeah, she's also the civics, teaches civics there, and so there was some interest from some students. She gave us some names, and then Ruth and I, we talked about, because some of the students were saying, well, why are you just talking to us? You should talk to other groups, like the Black Student Union. And then we were talking about, what about officers for the ASB and all that? And so then the discussion got later on and said, well, do we do this after school? Do we feed these kids? And, you know, and if we feed them, then they'll come. And it became obvious to us that this was just one of the three high schools that we could be talking to, and it'd be a lot of work, and that's where then a little more brainstorming happened, and we were thinking, well, maybe this is something more than what some part-time council members should handle. And Ruth, you want to?
Talking to the kids was fabulous. They were engaged and involved and sure that they knew what they wanted us to do as far as contacting other groups. Very insistent that we made sure we talked to everybody that might be interested. Just, you know, so inspiring to talk to teenagers these days, because they really are getting involved and active. And I've had personal circumstances that are preventing me from being able to put the time into it that it needs and deserves. And so I'm, you know, happy to have this discussion and see what we can do about. I hate having an idea and then making everybody else do the work, but sometimes you have to take a step back and realize that there's just no way either one of us could do it, because we have other commitments during the day, and there's just a lot. I mean, it's going to be fabulous no matter what, but it will require reaching out to a lot of people so that everyone knows that their voices can be heard in this way, and not to do that halfway. We really would like to make sure the kids all have the opportunity to participate. So,
yeah. And then at the same time, our concern is we wanted this to be legislative,
yes,
focused. focused, and the concern is perhaps we don't want it to go to, say, like Parks and Rec, and then it turns into what we've had before, because then it would lose that that type of focus. And so the challenge is really how do we do it? I've got some ideas, and I've asked some folks about that. The concern not to give it another thing for staff to do. So right. But at the same time, it is a challenge to find the time to do it. So maybe some outside forces can be drafted in.
Yeah.
And I can't say anything further on that until I've talked to a lot of people. How's that for being pretty vague?
There you go.
Yeah. But the idea is, we would, the feeling, and Ian's not here, but he shares the feeling, we really do want it to be people who are our kids that are interested in the legislative aspect of it and the political aspect of it.
Yeah, that was the goal all along. And not just about programs, not just about fun stuff, but about serious
issues. So if you all have ideas of how to do that.
Jump in.
Councilmember Sutton had her hand up.
If I could just real quick, only because I think with the news that they've shared, it sounds like what we may want to do as a council is step back and see what it is that we can or are willing to or are able to do by way of, one, I mean, is this something that we still want to do? And when I say want to do, I don't mean is it a desire of ours, because I think that's quite evident, but is it a challenge that we still want to try and tackle? And then, if that's the case, have a further discussion about how or where we can do that. And it sounds like you might have some ideas. So,
thank you. I was just thinking we have to start somewhere. And rather than trying to spread yourself, because it's a lot of groups, how about just maybe, because we want this to be legislative and so forth, how about just getting a little time to go to a civics class and just making a pitch and start there rather than trying to meet with all these groups, because you'll wear yourself out. I'd be more than happy to help you do that. I don't mind going into a classroom. I don't mind contacting teachers. That's what I did for a living. So let me help. Thank you.
I think with this discussion, I guess the first matter at hand is, how do we want to, when do we want to continue to try to do this work, and how do we want to do that? Do we want to continue having a committee, an ad hoc type committee that does that? Is this something that we want to work on together as a council and kind of restart the brainstorming? Any ideas on how you would like to handle that?
I actually think that would be an excellent idea. I think one thing that we came away with was that probably the best time to try to approach the student body was in January, because that it's after the holidays, before graduation, and all the other things that come up. And most of the time the students are there, they're not away or doing other things, and that would be, timing-wise, this teacher was talking about, that would be ideal. And, we did basically what you said. Basically, we went to a civics class, though it was the Honor Society at that time, middle of the day, and talked to those kids. And the only reason I say we were going to just try to concentrate on Lynnwood High was...
Yeah.
Been a while. I can't remember where we went, because it is, there are three of them, and that is a massive undertaking. But the one message that we came away with was they wanted us to reach out to the other students to make sure that everybody had the chance to hear what we had to say. And I'd like to honor that by fulfilling, being able to, if however we can, even if it's just call people and ask them to come here. I just think that was so important to the students that I want to make sure that we do some kind of outreach if we're going to do anything to make sure we include everyone. But I'm willing, I mean, I think another brainstorming session might be the way to go instead of, you know, to see what we can come up with. I think it's a great idea. Implementation is tricky.
I too think it's a wonderful idea. I think that I just don't have the words to express how wonderful I think it would be if we had youth that were involved in the process. I regret that I don't have time with all the other fire things going on. But I think hitting the civics classes is a good idea. What about talking with counselors and advisors at the high schools? And maybe they can give some feedback as to, you know, maybe they've walked down this path before and, you know, either with other groups outside of the schools or even within the schools. Talk with the advisors as to how best to target things. And maybe then we're not rethinking the process so much. I wish I had time to do it because it is a time commitment. And I support the decision not to give it back to staff, not to put it on their laps. I would really like for us to move forward with this, and I wish I had 10 more hours every day.
Councilor said.
Do you know if Lynnwood has a school newspaper?
They do.
How about putting an announcement in that? Because if you were really adamant about reaching as many students as you can, that might be one way.
I just have to say that if it continues as a task group, I will not be able to do it. I just can't. I can't do it. So if you want to do task group, that would be great, but I can't do it. So somebody else would have to step up.
I would like to offer that I think you need to develop the outcomes that you want from this task force. I mean, you can't go stand in front of a class or put an ad in a newspaper or talk to counselors if you don't know what your product is, what you're selling to them. So you sound like you understand what you want. You want it to be legislative in nature, but I think you need to decide, here's what it looks like, and we want to invite you to do it. Whose schedule does this fit in, students? Because it's unclear to me what you're really trying to ask them to do, and you have some specific ideas of what you're trying to get out of it. So I think starting at the end here with what outcome do you want with youth engagement, you'll have a much better success. You'll have much better success in selling it and recruiting, I think. Council President.
If my memory serves me correctly, and it used to quite a bit, not so much now, when we first had the discussion of the youth council or a youth commission, I remember one of the things that we discussed was having a student or a number of students that really worked with the council, that would be willing to do and help and learn. So whether that is social networking and outreach through social networking, being almost like a legislative page, I think that's what they're called, and you know, and contributing, whether it's solely or in a team, to issues that the council deals with that may affect them or definitely affect them. And you know, a lot of the issues that we're discussing, I imagine they also discuss in current events classes and things like that, homelessness, opioids, a lot of the things at the local level also bleed into national level and vice versa. And I think getting some interest that way in presenting that, I mean, if that's something that we're looking at doing and how we might be able to do that, that's one of those things that we could present to them. So there are, as the mayor said, concrete ideas, concrete tasks or asks that we have with solidified outcomes that they will also be able to present. Because for students, especially, I know some of the other things we talked about were maybe youth that are 18, 19, maybe have graduated high school or are in other curricular type schools and activities, but using an opportunity like this for things like college applications, for job applications, or just for experience in general, I think we could do that, and I don't know that it would be a very tough sell if they're able to get some kind of experience, because I think that will allow them to do something. You know, a lot of times there's a commission, a board where they can come in and sit and talk, but things don't necessarily happen from that. But when there's hands-on involvement, I think that's something that would appeal to a number of students and youth that we may be able to bring in to do that.
One point Ian was talking about having it be time limited and having a project like an ordinance or looking at a set of rules and regulations and our, you know, the things that we have, and having them do something, get it from the beginning to the end, whether it was an initiative that they wanted to see bring forward, and that would be the experience. That would be what the council, the youth council, was going to do, is to have a time limited and say, this is the experience we're going to have, whether it was creating a resolution or if it was looking at something else. But something that would be, like you said, it would be something you could actually produce and have your name on and use for references or for college admissions or for community service or some of those things. And maybe it doesn't necessarily, to begin with, have to be an ongoing committee. Maybe it could be a very job-specific committee instead. So that's a thought, too.
Councilmember Frizzell?
So, Councilmember Ross, in the time that you guys met, did you do some groundwork on some of that stuff that you can hand off?
I seem to think that we did. It's been a while. We had some work product we could put together that we only had the one meeting, but it was very fruitful. I felt like it was very fruitful. Mm. And we had a couple, I mean, at the school. We met other than that.
And which school was that?
That was Lynnwood High. I'll have to look through my stuff and see if I can find the material that we wrote down.
Okay.
You know, AWC Action Days, and many of you go, that may be sort of an end stipend, if you will, to a couple of youth commissioners, and you start them in on your project early in the school year and work alongside of you with the legislative highlights that are happening in Olympia, and then take them with you. Put that in your budget for next year.
Yeah, I'd like a page. Everybody should have a page. Being facetious. But I think, maybe the idea of a big youth commission is difficult.
school to start with, that really, if we could do a focused assignment, get them in there in September, say, you know, we want you to study
housing affordability.
Yeah, housing affordability, and give us an answer, would you, real quick. But an issue that we would like them to look at, and and then they can come in January or February to Olympia.
And they had completely different ideas.
Yeah.
And in some ways of what we thought they would want to talk about. School security was one of the the top.
Yeah.
That's the first thing they said was school security. And maybe that's the way to go. I don't know. You know, it's hard to know. It's hard to know what to do.
So Evan Chin, our new HR director, is building a robust internship program for the city. And so many departments have interns or have been building job descriptions for that. And so maybe that's a way to start a page, have an intern come in and do what you want them to do, whatever that job is. And we'll have paid and unpaid interns in the system. So start there with a couple of interns.
I don't know, do high schools have senior projects still?
No.
Not anymore? Okay.
Mark Masson told me that it's the senior social studies classes where they do civics, and all high schools have senior social studies. And that's the class that they do their civics work in.
So it sounds like that it's something that we're interested in continuing, at least is finding some way to get youth involved, whether it's a youth commission or some kind of legislative aides or page. And I think just from the timing of everything, that as we're coming to a close of the school year, that it would be actually a very good time to get into the schools to prepare for September. So as school starts in September, we can say, this is what we're looking to do. And I think the idea of working that, probably it's about a semester, right? Working through that fall semester, and then in January, talking with or negotiating with the school if they would allow a day or 2 days, whatever it is, for the students to go down to Olympia and do that with the AWC action days. So I think if we work now on two kind of specific things, one, the job description or what we're looking for, and contacting whether it's one or all of the high schools that are, you know, Lynnwood city limits, if you will, or in the school district, yeah, exactly, to kind of start that process, see what we can do to present that to whether it's the principal and the counselors and then the civics teachers and then eventually to the students, and then also during that period develop what it is so that when it comes to September we'll have some ideas. And I think with what Councilmember Ross mentioned, one of the things I think would be most beneficial is rather than saying we'd like you to work on legislation for this issue, give options as to, you know, you can work on legislation or, you know, whatever else, something with the city by way of ordinances or rulemaking or, you know, something along those lines, but a few different options that they can then work toward giving them more of a choice. I think if we just left it wide open, it'll be difficult to come up with something, usually, that everyone could agree on. But having an option or a set of options to choose from and then be able to take that and illustrate how, one, that helps the council and the city, two, how it helps them, and then, you know, be able to present that to whether it's at the school district level, whether it's at ABC Action Days, you know, some of the meetings that we have with representatives would be a great opportunity for them to meet and greet with other legislative and senatorial state leaders. Any objections to that idea? No? Okay. So I know that it wasn't planned to get on to this right now, but are there ideas of what we'd want for in a job description? Because I think that it would be, I mean, we have the time to do it. I don't know if we'll have as many ideas as if we give some opportunity, but there may be some that come now. So if we have any of those opportunities and I can write them down, or the options, I can start writing them down as to what kind of things that we're looking for. And then as we go, this can be one of those topics that we have kind of as the, I don't know if rotating is the correct term, but as we find where we have meetings that end early, we can bring this topic back up, continue to develop the job description and how we want to present this to the different schools to see if it's even something that they'll allow, and if not, how we can adjust it so that it's something that they'd allow.
One thing that we talked about at that meeting was, and they're kind of perked up about it, and maybe one of the options we could offer is for them to facilitate a roundtable discussion from the beginning to the end, you know, whether it's finding the venue and preparing the materials and getting the invitations and finding out who they want to invite and what the topic is going to be, and be in charge of that kind of an event from the beginning to the end. And that might be an option for participation, and have it be a discussion on something that they want to talk about with their peers. And I mean, that's an opportunity to do something it may not be able to do otherwise.
And when you say it, you mean like at the high school, kind of like conversations with the council?
It could be
kind of set up. I mean,
it could be conversations with the council, or it could be something like we had when we had the discussions with, and the police came and we had discussions at Trinity Lutheran about the racial issues in Lynnwood, and people came and. You know, it could be, they may be interested in learning how to do that sort of thing. I don't know. There was some interest in that idea. So could be...
Just a facilitating a roundtable community discussion.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And coming forward with some work product from that, and some, and maybe some recommendations about something. Again, allowing them to take the reins and do the work and come up with the topics and those kinds of things, that might be an opportunity that they would be interested in.
Yeah. Yes. Hello. I think it would be advantageous to talk with the adults in the group first to see what they think is a good model and how to get students involved in that process, because I think that the roundtable idea, while it's good, I think that's a big lot of it's a big project for some teenagers to handle, and it might be another alternative would be to invite them here for a roundtable and start that way with inviting, I don't know, four from each of the two schools to come and tell us what's important to them, and kind of get some consensus before we just target issues and move forward. But I think talking with the advisors at the high schools would give us a better idea of what they have done in the past, what kids can be expected, kids, young adults, next generation, future leaders of America. You know, maybe something that's in their wheelhouse. And I would be willing to go to Meadowdale High School and know an advisor over there, and I could information gather.
Mentioned earlier that you would be willing to do some of that. Maybe you could do Lynnwood High School. I don't want to take control of this.
I think we need to figure out too what kind of time commitment we're asking for these young adults. They're busy too, and you know, can we approach it? Can they get credit for this? If it turns into something where we're going to ask them to, for 3 months or for the semester or the quarter or whatever it is, to devote one night a week, can they get credit for it then through their civics class?
I think we probably have a series of conversations. I'm interested in what the adults have already kind of blessed, and maybe they've got other programs where students go outside of the school and
do activities. When you say adults, are you speaking of counselors and teachers and
yes.
at the schools?
Teachers and counselors.
At the schools, okay.
Yes. So I will make a connection and talk with Meadowdale people.
Today.
Wednesday.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
After the 15th.
Oh, I know.
It's the 17th. Okay. We'll have you do that, and then we'll talk about that council mm-hmm. leadership meeting, just to see what Meadowdale High School has. Because I think generally the school district kind of dictates, if you will, what happens with that. So what happens at Meadowdale is likely to be very similar at Lynnwood. And so we'll get that information, and then we can bring that forward. And from there, I think we can have further discussion about where we want to go with that. What we can do and what options are available to us by way of the things that were mentioned with the credit and the time commitment and, all that kind of stuff. So we'll have Council Vice President Frizzell talk with a adult at Meadowdale High School.
An advisor, student advisor.
Oh, student advisor, which I assume is an adult.
Yes.
and then we'll bring that back at a subsequent meeting. We'll probably plan that for the third Wednesday, but if there's another meeting where we have time, then that will be one of the kind of revolving things on the agenda to discuss and bring forward.
So everybody should think about what they want the job description to look like? Or are we going to wait on that?
I think ideas are always, I think we can adjust that as we need to, depending on what news comes back from the school. Okay. So I think it would be a good idea to continue with pursuing at least a legislative page or aid job description, because even if we can't do it this time, having some idea, foundation of what we would like, we can always move that forward from year to year, school year to school year as needed.
Okay.
So that will be part of our next Youth Commission discussion, along with a report from Council Vice President Frizzell, is some ideas about what we would like to see or what ideas we have about a job description for a legislative aide or page or a team that we can put together to do some work.
Great.
And be involved.
anything else on this specific topic?
We've talked about this before, and we've talked about a page, and we've talked about a variety of things about this. And I think that we need to think about not just credit for this person or a couple people for a page or legislative type thing, but, you know, recommendations, college recommendations, scholarship money, things like that we can do with our budget. And the kids have a lot of, there's a lot of competition out there of other better things to do. And, and so I think we have to consider that in our planning anyway.
All right. Okay. Well, you do not have an exec session tonight. I don't have further comments. Any council comments, Council President? Council Vice President?
I have some comments. I was wondering if anyone else had had time to look at the training that we got set up through elected officials essentials. Did everybody get an email that you're aware of, or you could get logged in and you could start viewing the training? I just want to make sure that it's been made available. If not, Beth has cheat sheets for us, if anybody would like them, as to how to get logged in. Oh, Shannon needs one back over here. Thank you. And then she also went to the extent of giving everyone a packet as to what the webinar series entails. So one for Ian there. So now that I have a little more time on my hands, I'll be taking a look at those, and it'd be interesting to talk with other people and see if they're interesting, if they're informative, if there's things that we can put to work out of there. And then just a reminder that Beth has the library set up and ready to go for checking out materials. I know we all sit around and have nothing else to do, but perhaps we could, you know, commit maybe 2 hours a month to something. I'm going to try to.
Training.
Yes. I just bought a new bookcase and put all my books on it that I've been stacking up in the last 5 months. So, lots to do.
Yeah, Council President.
On that note, would council members be interested in and or find it beneficial to have, and I don't know exactly how it's set up, if you can always go to archives and things, or if it's just a specific webinar that they have, but if we had two or three that were of interest to the council that we could say, you know, this month we'll discuss these three, because that way, you know, we have something, because we could all, if we all watch a different one and then we came to discuss, we wouldn't necessarily have anything to discuss with each other. But if we chose specific ones that we think would benefit the council as a whole, then we could say, you know, this is what we're looking at for this month, and, you know, come back on the third Wednesday, and we can discuss any one of the three or all three or whatever and go from there. Anyone?
If we just want to tackle one at a time, in July we are doing a live webinar with the Jurassic Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
at our Wednesday night July meeting, so our regular Wednesday meeting, old Jurassic Parliament.
And this is, it's different than what she's done before in that it's, I think, an hour. It's only an hour, and it's more of a refresher. Like she said, it's a webinar, so we'll just be in here, and she'll present that to us. And
is she live?
Uh-huh.
Yes. And we have the option that we can purchase the webinar electronic, on some electronic.
Yeah, in some format where we can watch it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, and that will be on basically Robert's Rules kinds of things. These other webinars, you can log on at the museum and just work your way through them, my understanding.
So, I think maybe what we'll do then is Council Vice President and I will take a look at them and see what we have, the listing, or if you want to do that on your own and send some ideas to Beth. We'll do the same and just send some that we think as a council we can do. And if they mesh, then, those are the ones that we'll choose. But we'll do that and then send out an email and notify you of what we'll do for the month of May and in the subsequent months throughout the year. All right.
All right. Any other council comments?
Yes.
Councilmember Hurst.
I have
nothing
I borrowed.
From Alaska Airlines. But, so, here are all these people flying around Alaska, and here's,
this is show and tell.
Oh, man, that's great. Here's the ad for the convention center, and then no, and what's it is great, and they even show in the little insert here, they show here's Painfield and here's Lynnwood, and here's the bad news that SeaTac, is 30 some miles away, and no, it's not. We don't put anybody else there. But then it was part of this. They unfortunately called it Seattle North Country, right? But it's about Snohomish County and all the things that we need to do, all the cool things, unfortunately, there's two cool things for Edmonds and just the convention center for us. But, whale watching in Edmonds and shopping in their little downtown.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. But I just was thrilled to death, that the convention center is there, and Lynnwood starts here, and so I think it really is great for our tourist people that put this out. It's April 2019. Fresh off the back of a chair in Alaska Airlines.
Just so you know, the reason why the convention center's a bigger part of that too is because they help pay for it as well. We collaborated with them between the Tourism Advisory Council monies and them, and so great way to help share resources. But they're going to be so excited to see that. Maybe they already have one by now, but
yeah. And there's a nice little article on the Painfield Airport.
Yeah, that's so cool. That's very good.
And what a great experience it is to go up there and sit and drink in front of a fireplace and wait for the plane to come in. Well, that's basically what.
That's what it looks like.
And you have Wi-Fi and a very expensive chandelier from New York. If you look up in the air. Yeah, he had to. He was panicked. Well, he's got two of them, and they weren't there for a long time. But and they have Beecher's cheese. I don't think it's in there yet, but it will be. And behind some of the facade, I signed one of the posts, so my name is somewhere in that building.
So you're
still in
these
angry. And graffiti that is well hidden. But it's a cool airport, and it is going to be great.
Yeah. All right. Any other comments?
Then I think we can adjourn.
Yes.
Alrighty then.
All right.
Thank you.